Alamance County is pleased to be
Our meeting is now in order. Mr. Boswell, do you have the invocation, please?
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for all the blessings you have bestowed upon us and all the people of this great nation. And even in these times of economic hardships, let us know that we are blessed. And dear God, I ask a special request for the Lambeth family as they had the loss of Susan, who was so much an advocate in our community for people in need. Let her life be a guiding light for all of us. And dear God, be with us as we go about making the decisions for Alamance County tonight, and teach us to be instruments of unity and reconciliation for each of our neighbors tonight. Fill us with the zeal that is contagious and push us to behold and be creative as we go about our meeting. Let us be realistic at all times, never neglecting common sense. And let nothing stop us in works of mercy, and may we do all these things in a manner that is pleasing to you. Amen.
I just want to remind you, if anyone wants to have a comment tonight, please sign the book now. You want to speak? Okay. Because it is public comment time. Miss Rossi?
Yes.
Mr. Rossi. We do have a 3-minute time limit, if you don't mind keeping it at 3 minutes, okay?
I think I can do that.
It would be okay.
I try to be not particularly long-winded.
Okay, we'll have a buzzer that goes off.
All right.
Thank you.
Commissioners, thank you very much for your time. Peter, speak to you about 287G this evening, and I'd like to tell you that I'm an attorney that practices law in the county. I've been here for about 9 years. I practice immigration law, and I also practice criminal law. I'm in district court 5 days out of the week. I see Judge Lambeth, Judge Robertson, Judge Abernathy, Judge Allen. And what I've seen with the advent of 287G is a lot of arrests for offenses that never used to carry any kind of arrest before, specifically speeding tickets. I've seen people arrested for. I've seen people arrested for fishing without a license. I've seen people arrested for driving without an operator's license. And the strange coincidence is that this happened after the advent of 287G. And as we're looking at fiscal matters, I was wondering if the commissioners had ever considered what the cost of these policies might be. Because what happens is that when the magistrate sees the person who's been arrested, they will give them a court date. Frequently, that court date will be about 3 weeks out in the future, or perhaps a month in the future, maybe 2 weeks. And it's my understanding that the money from the federal government does not kick in until such time as either the defendant makes bail, or is found guilty, or is found not guilty, and the detainer is exercised. And what I see is that a lot of times it seems that the taxpayers in the county are paying for the housing of people on relatively minor charges. And I was wondering whether the commissioners had ever looked at that, and if they would, if they would be willing to share those figures with us. And that's it.
I think the sheriff has those figures at some point. If you would call him, I feel like he would be glad to share that with you. I don't have those figures on me, but
we,
I, but
we pretty much went over those figures
last meeting.
But
Mr. Johnson would certainly be glad for you to come and talk with him. He's shaking his head yes.
All right.
So if you would like to put some figures on that, Mr. Rossi, he'll be glad to assist you.
Thank you, Commissioner Massey. What was the general sense? Was it something that was losing money for the county or not? Since you've seen the figures.
No. We're really gaining money for the county. Like, what was it, $2 million, over $2 million, and maybe higher this year that we're getting back into the county?
Basically, okay. The figures that we saw at the last meeting didn't indicate a high number of the types of arrests you're talking about, specifically speeding, speeding. There were some NOLs, but not a great number when you compare them to other counties in the area. It was matter of fact, Alamance County was one of the lowest when you compare it to other counties. And most of the folks that are in the county jail are folks that are here from other counties for the 287G program. In other words, we are housing them. And certainly, we're being paid by ICE, you know, to do that. So
that would be a moneymaker.
That's what we're saying, yes, sir.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Rossi, I would like to ask you make a reflection on this. Before 287G, when somebody was stopped out here without a license, with no ID, no proof of anything, it was obvious that they weren't arrested, possibly, at that point. They were just given a ticket.
That's correct.
The name of the address was taken for what it was worth, and then there was a high percentage that didn't show up for court because I've had clerks of courts tell me it didn't really matter whether they showed up for court or not because the bond money had been paid or the ticket had been paid. But the 287G is quite clear. It's taking in people who can't prove who they are. You take them in, you check them out, you find out that they're illegal, then the process starts. But, you know, I think it's grasping for straws to try to shoot down 287G with this financial inquiry. This is something y'all have been doing for quite a while, and I just think it's grasping for straws, frankly.
Well, I appreciate your opinion, Commissioner.
Well, I've had one for a long time on this issue.
We all do. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, Mr. Rossi. Okay, if there are no more public comments, I will close the public comments at this time. And we will go to Piedmont Health Senior Care. Ms. Ratcliffe is going to speak on that. She is executive director, and we'll be glad to hear you talk about that, Ms. Ratcliffe.
Thank you, and thank you for the opportunity to be here. Can you hear me? Soft voice, but I'll try and speak up. I appreciate
I can't hear you in the back sometimes. That's all right.
Can y'all hear me back there?
Okay.
Thanks for your time. I'll take just about 5 minutes. Help me stay honest to that. I wanted to thank you all for the opportunity to be here and tell you about a new program in town serving Alamance and Caswell County. This is one of two programs in the state, and so I think Alamance and Caswell should be commended for having taken the leadership role in piloting this program. We are one of 60 in the nation, and this is a program under Medicare and Medicaid called PACE, which stands for Program of All-Inclusive Care for the Elderly. And I do have some brochures. I might just pass those around if you would like to see them.
Is that what we have?
Do y'all have them?
We have this. Yeah, we have copies of
them. And so the goal of PACE, or our particular program, is called Piedmont Health Senior Care, but it is a model of care called PACE, Program of All-Inclusive Care for the Elderly. The goal is to enable a nursing home eligible senior, so the frail elderly, with the opportunity to remain at home and age in place by providing them with all services needed to stay safe and healthy at home. And that's the whole spectrum of services that are traditionally covered under Medicare and Medicaid services. Plus, it has lots of flexibility to provide, because we are regulated by Medicare and Medicaid under different regulations. We are not restricted as far as the scope of services, the duration of services, acuity of care, or anything. We just must provide whatever care is needed for somebody to remain safe and healthy at home. That includes primary care, preventive care, specialty services, hospitalization, home care, transportation, medications, the list goes on, nursing home care if needed. 93% of participants in this model of care are able to remain in their home until they disenroll from the program, and the largest reason for disenrollment is death. So this program is very effective at keeping people at home and let them age in place. 7% of the participants, something will change during their course of time in the program, and it's no longer safe for them to stay at home. That may be a result of their change in their health status, or perhaps their primary caregiver. There's a change in that status, and perhaps that person's no longer available. 7% will go into a nursing home, and that's the best place for them. So We're located at the old Alamance Eye Center on Vaughn Road. I invite you all to stop by anytime. We're open Monday through Friday, 8 to 5. Access to care is 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We have a physician and a nurse practitioner that's on call around the clock. So we are a program of Piedmont Health Services, which is an agency that's been in this community for many, many years. It's an organization that runs the Charles Drew Community Health Center, the Scott Community Health Center, and Prospect Hill up in Caswell County. This program, I'm here today just to let you know about it and to ask your advice if you have any ideas on how we can get the word out to citizens of Alamance County, your neighbors, people, groups you may know that would be interested in hearing about it that might benefit from it. It is open to folks who are 55 years of age and older, living in Alamance or Caswell counties, nursing home eligible, which is determined by the state, and our physician can help them with that assessment. And at the time of enrollment, with the provision of our services, they can live safely at home. And so that is defined. That may be that they need 2 hours a day of home care services to help with activities of daily living like grooming or bathing, feeding. But as long as they are able to live safely in the community and they meet the other three criteria, then they are eligible for this program. That's sort of it in a nutshell, and I'm going to try and stick to just about 5 minutes. Okay. If you have any questions, I think that's the more important thing, how I might help answer.
What are your numbers, Ms. Rackett?
So we just opened. Thank you. We just became certified, and we have 12 participants currently. We're looking to have about 150 at this site. Beyond that, the program is successful because it is very individualized care. It's a panel of 1 to 100 participants, for one doctor to 100 participants, whereas in more traditional settings, you see a physician having about 2,000 for primary care. So the care is very individualized. It's coordinated by a multidisciplinary team of caregivers. When somebody is looking to enroll in the program, there's an assessment conducted from the social worker. We have a team on site, social worker, pharmacist, dietitian, nurse, physician, nursing aide, recreational therapist. All of these folks come together, do their own individual assessments, ask about the needs and the goals of this participant in this particular discipline, come together to create a plan of care that's presented to the participant and their family members. Family is very critical to the success of this program as well, and it goes from there. So the care is very, very individualized, and that's why we'd like to maintain a fairly small size for this site of just 150.
So, yeah.
Now, are you working with the hospital?
We are. Yeah, it's a great question. Exactly. So it's... we have contract services. Thank you. I didn't say that. For services we cannot provide directly as Piedmont Health Senior Care, we have contracts in place with existing community providers such as the hospital, Pernodal, other area providers to provide those specialty services or acute services that we can't offer.
Okay. How do these people get to your site?
We do provide transportation. That is a service we're currently contracting out. We have two providers, ACTA and Bigelow Transportation. We also contract out home care. That's something that we may down the road do in-house. But starting out, it felt right to utilize existing community providers and not just create new ones. So, yeah.
So you're looking for ways to further network.
Well, yes, and to get the word out, you know, this is a new model of care, and I think it's kind of complicated, and as somebody said to me, it sounds too good to be true. So, but it's real, and it's a program that was born out of Piedmont Health Services' recognition that we were not serving our elderly appropriately, that folks were falling through the cracks. It's very fragmented, as we all know. It's hard as we age. We get more complicated. Our health issues become more complicated, and it's harder for us to manage and navigate the system. And this is a program where we coordinate all the services and provide all the services for these folks and for their families. It's really about caring for families in the community. It enables an aging, an adult child who's a primary caregiver now to their aging parent to retain their job, for instance, not give up that job and have to come home and stay, take care of mom or whatnot. So that's another aspect to it. I've talked too long. I wanted to thank you so much for your help and support on the planning committee.
Mrs. Ratliff, have you talked to Willie Mae Kearns?
She has been fabulous. Oh, yes. Huge help to us, yes. Thank you so much. Thank you for the opportunity.
Okay, Mr. Bass? Where are you? Hey, Bass. This is the Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation Award.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you all for allowing us a few minutes on your busy schedule to present what I think is a real crown to our county employees. And I have with me Ms. Glenda Lennons, and Glenda is our Health Promotion Coordinator, Wellness Coordinator, Health Department. And she basically ramrods a lot of the activities that we have in Wellness, not only the Health Department, but in the county. And Alamance County and our county employees have been awarded the Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation Bronze Achievement Award. County employees, the proponents were at the Health Department DSS, but we had other county employees and their families, and we raised $2,345.61. And it was raised primarily through having a walk where we had sponsors and donations to the family members and staff. We also had Dress Down Wednesdays. We took the collections of those monies in. We also sold sneakers that had our names on it and had those posted in our lobby. But all these fundraising events together brought a really nice little sum to help folks with the juvenile diabetes and diabetes research. And as you all know in our report to the state, diabetes is one of the three leading causes of death in Alamance County. So we would like to present to you all this plaque as a part of it. And again, thank you all for allowing us to participate in the program. And you're quite welcome. So there you go.
Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate it.
Yes, ma'am, you're quite welcome. And also along the lines of wellness, you have in your packet a program of Alamance Walks. And it's an invitation if you all have the time at one of the walking events and could join us as a distinguished public official to show your support. We appreciate it. Thank
and I
all.
Told Barry if he would, I would.
So we're going to do that, Ms. Manson. We're going to do it.
Did I not, Barry?
Yes, ma'am. We'll figure out the date. We'll go together.
All right. So join us, okay? Okay, the next thing on our agenda is the Ms. Horton, the business personal property audit.
Yes, ma'am. Over the past couple of months, the board has heard requests from different businesses requesting waiver of tax penalties. And the general statute does give the board the authority to waive those penalties, but when do you waive them? So I just wanted to offer a brief explanation of how the discovery process goes and when we may bring some requests to the board for you to act on the request. When a discovery is issued, we send out a letter to the taxpayer telling them we have made a discovery, and then given those taxpayers 30 days to contact our office in which they could appeal the discovery. If the taxpayer does exercise that right and call our office, we set up what we call an assessor's conference with the taxpayer. And the taxpayer comes in and discusses with myself and the staff issues in the audits, whether supplies should be discovered, whether property is listed as real or personal. And a lot of times this portion of the appeals process is really a big learning tool to the taxpayers and to our office also of the type of business that is the taxpayer is engaged in. If after the assessor's conference the taxpayer is not satisfied with the results that I have made, they're issued a letter and given 15 or 30 days to appeal to the Board of Equalization and Review. And this is a citizen board appointed by the Board of Commissioners to hear and act upon appeals where the tax office and the taxpayers do not agree. We just had a meeting last week of the Board of ENR, and we had two businesses that appealed to the Board of ENR. So in all the audits that we've done, we've only had two to go to the Board of ENR. After the Board of ENR makes their ruling, if the taxpayer is still not satisfied with the results that they have been notified on, they can appeal to the Property Tax Commission in Raleigh. Now, taxpayers can represent themselves at this commission, but it's based on legal rules and evidence. So a lot of times taxpayers do hire attorneys when the appeal gets to this process. So it starts getting more costly to the taxpayers. We appeal to the Property Tax Commission. And since I've been here in 2 years, we've had no appeals to the Property Tax Commission yet. So that's just to let you know that in either the Assessor's Conference or the Board of E&R Conference, we usually get much of the issues worked out. And then from the Property Tax Commission, the taxpayer can go on to the Court of Appeals, which is the final steps. Now, I give you these steps to let you know that the taxpayers do have due process to be heard, and that we do listen to them and in deciding what value they will be taxed on. Once the appeals process is completed, the value is set. And as the assessor, I generate tax bills, if needed, for current year and 5 years back, which includes the penalties. And those tax bills are then mailed to the taxpayers. When the taxpayers receive those tax bills, at that point in time, they can petition the Board of Commissioners to waive any portion of the tax, to waive the penalties or do away with all 5 years discovery, whatever it be the pleasure of the board. So I think that sometimes, well, quite often, taxpayers, when we go through the appeals process, their first question is, how much is it going to cost me? And sometimes they forget about the steps that's involved to get the value right first. Because even if the Board of Commissioners did decide to waive those penalties and do away with those back year taxes, it becomes the basis for listing their taxes for current year and future years. So that appeals process is very important as we walk through. Again, I just wanted to make sure that the board and the taxpayers realize the process, because if they forget about the appeals process, then when they get the tax bills, sometimes it's too late for them to do anything about the bill. So the board has not had any requests currently to waive penalties. I'm sure there'll be some to come in the next few months or years. They'll probably be more than one. And there may be a point in time when the board should decide that the penalty should be waived. But there also may be a point in time when the board says, no, you know, these penalties should be in place. So I just wanted to make these points to the boards and just maybe offer a recommendation that you may want to wait and act on whether to waive any portion of the discovery bill on an individual basis, and that we will bring them to the board at the appropriate time.
We actually have had people to call and not want us to, you know, want us to do away with it, to waive them. So I have.
Well, and they may have, but we've not issued any tax bills yet. And I will bring them to you when we, at that point in time.
Now, is there not some repercussions for us if we waive those things? Is what we?
Well, there, and Clyde will probably have to help me on this.
The penalties and interest you can adjust. The tax itself can't.
So we cannot waive the taxes, per se.
You can.
I think it comes out of our pockets, doesn't it, Clyde, if we do that?
Well, if you do, and you found not to have legal justification for it, each commissioner is personally liable.
That's the tax code.
My wife wouldn't be happy about losing
that. We can do the penalties without any repercussions. So that's what I had heard, that we might, that we would be responsible. But now you don't think we have, that we will, or is that not what you're telling us, if we waive the taxes? Are you saying we can legally waive the taxes?
Well, Clyde's the expert here.
I think you can waive the penalties and interest.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. Taxes have to be paid.
Yeah. I think it's 380, which Clyde's referring to, holds the board personally liable should they waive any tax that some other taxpayer had to pay. But there's a little clause in 312 that says that the board can waive a portion or the taxes associated with a discovery only. So that's open to legal interpretation as to whether it can or not. But I trust Clyde on that legal issue there.
Kim, I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
And a lot of phone calls. Is there anything in black and white that says this is what you need to list. You need to list in a daycare center, for instance, crayons and paper and da-da-da-da-da. Is there something in black and white that so everybody's on the same page? And maybe, you know, in the future, we won't need to go through all this. Hopefully not.
There's nothing as detailed as what you just asked. What the statute says is all property is subject to taxes. That's it.
Okay. If I have a farm and I just filled up with fuel, mm-hmm. is that taxed?
On
January 1st?
Yes, ma'am. The fuel is taxable if you're a farmer. But again, what value do we tax you on are all issues that we work out during the appeals process. And, you know, sometimes we tax this amount and sometimes it's a different amount, but it's all on an individual basis, and it has to do with, you know, how this business is operated and, you know, what your income threshold is or your expense threshold is and those type of items. So it's difficult to put those instructions on a piece of paper. But basically, all property is subject to taxes unless it's exempted or excluded by state statutes.
Are you planning on having another workshop for these people? Because I couldn't come to either one that you had.
We had two workshops for the farmers, and we had close to 100 in attendance. I think Mr. Vines could probably testify to that.
142, yeah. I believe.
And right now we don't have another one scheduled, but we're certainly not opposed to it. Mr. Vines Farm Bureau and the Ag Extension Office worked great in getting the facility set up. All I had to do was be there. So we can certainly have another one. I do know we plan to have one this time next year and make this an annual kind of workshop every year for the farming community. And then maybe reach out to the smaller business community, maybe the mom-and-pop stores and businesses.
Yeah, on that, I know it's bad time now with tax time and everything, but I think a lot of CPAs probably need a refresher as to what you're expecting out of the people they're filing taxes for.
Sure, we will work
and
with their association.
Another workshop you could possibly.
Yeah, and tailor a workshop towards their business. Or.
And for us, too, you know, be there.
For the last two meetings, we've had people under public speak.
Yes, ma'am.
I think Mr. Vines was one, and
Frank.
Mr. Bill, Frank Bill was the other one that came forward and spoke mm-hmm. at length. And it seems that they would like a committee of business people, tax people, board, and anybody else that's interested to come up with something, and I don't know, may have to refer to Clyde, to come up with something concrete for businesses in Alamance County.
I'm certainly willing to work and whatever we need to do to get the word out to the taxpayers.
Well, I think most of them didn't understand part of it and didn't realize what they had to list. It's because I think previously they were not told they had to list a lot of this stuff. But I know there's just something about ignorance does not excuse you. So, yes, sir, I'll let you talk. Go ahead.
There's just been a big confusion in the tax office in the last few years that when you go down to the tax office and ask for information of how you need to be listing your taxes and you don't get the proper information, you can call three times and you can get three different answers. I know Kim has been working on this and trying to get this resolved, but there has been a lot of misinformation put out. People were misunderstood that when they, especially in the farming community, in 1986 when this was done away with, there's a lot of them that did not know that they were even supposed to be filing that business property tax. And they felt like that was under personal, and that's what they were told at that time. I know this is out of your jurisdiction, you know, of time. But I have talked with young farmers, I've talked with others that have no knowledge of this, have went to the tax office and asked, trying to do the correct things, and have been given the wrong information. I don't mean to down to the department, but I know for a fact that one young man went down there to file And he was told, well, just give me an estimate of how much you've got, and we'll start from here. Mm-hmm. And that's clearly not the way to do it, and it's causing problems all the way around. And I just feel like that it needs to be some kind of clear definition of, you know, that people understand, even small businesses along with farmers and small businesses as well, is that they are supposed to be filing the business property tax, because so many of them do not. Yeah. And I think we just, if we could get that information out, if we could sit down and come up with some kind of formula as to where, you know, we could work and get the public educated, that we wouldn't be in this problem now.
Well, the workshops is what's going to help.
Yeah.
Them. I mean, you know, that's what they're for.
You know, also other one thing is, you know, if our laws had been followed along as they should have, and each one received these audits in 8 years, this wouldn't be a problem either.
We can't go back and fix that, and we can't make these taxes go away either.
The future, we just need to, we need to move forward, but we need to be sure that people understand.
Well, we can't set a precedent either. That's the whole thing, too. We can't say, well, we're going to, you know, forgive these people's penalties or whatever, because there again, you're going to have everybody in Alamance County wanting you to forgive a penalty. So it's got to be a fairness thing there somewhere. So, but we will work on it.
About the appeals process. Mm-hmm. And don't forget, it's not a fact of not forgetting, is that they don't know they can do this. You know, just like the extension. I never noted. I was late last year because I was out of town. And I went down to file it, and I wasn't told then that I could even get an extension at that time. Okay. It's just not, you know, the public doesn't know.
It's a matter of communication.
I think we've come a long way. So I talked with Paul Walker today. He says looking better, and as far as communication and the understanding, and I think the Ag Committee meeting coming up, they're going to discuss it again. So as far as the farmers, I think it's starting to look
We recognize the problem now,
yes,
I assure you that I will
do everything I can, and on the Farm Bureau side as well, to get farmers informed and the business public. You know, we just didn't realize this was a problem, and we've got to work forward on this.
Well, that was the reason I suggested maybe getting the CPAs involved, because I know a lot of farmers that use CPAs to help them out with taxes. And if they can help them
out. And I ain't so sure that that's where we don't need some legislation that requires CPAs to at least notify the business clients, because we go to those people for their expert opinions and to tell us what we need to do, because we don't know how to do it, and we depend on these people that we're paying to guide us in the right direction.
We have a suggestion that we do a video on this.
Training video.
That
might be what.
There you go.
Thank you, Mr. Boyer.
Yeah.
That's a good idea.
He was trying to mouth it to me. But thank you, Bob. But anyway, thank you. So the next thing is the interim county manager reports.
Madam Chair, just have one item. I just want to give the board an update on the conversion, the county's conversion to the 800 megahertz communication system. We did close on the bank loan towards the end of last year. We have ordered back in December, placed an order for most of the equipment and radios. The renovations to the CCOM area downstairs should be completed sometime in May, and we're looking at converting over to the system around October the 1st. That's what we're shooting for. So hopefully we'll have everything in place at that point and be able to convert over to it at that time.
And that's all I have. Are we still on track as far as the money's concerned?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Anything else here? Okay, then next thing we're going to go to is the consent agenda. And I'm going to read what we've done is we've moved all the budget amendments to the consent agenda. If anybody up here wants to pull one, then we will. Otherwise, we're going to leave them on the consent agenda. And we all have that information in our packets. Are there any questions on any of this in the consent agenda?
Is that a reversal from when we had all finance budget amendments out of the consent agenda, didn't we?
I was not here.
I'll answer. Correct me if I'm wrong, Pat. In the past, it used to be in the consent agenda.
pulled out.
Got pulled off.
About a year ago.
Our thought, and I talked to the chair about this, was let's put it in the consent agenda. All the information that you would have really from when somebody does a presentation to you is actually in your agenda packet. You may not have any questions on them. If not, you just approve them as part of the consent agenda. However, if you do have a question on them, you can pull them out. And we thought that would probably speed up the process. Yeah, but the ones that you do have questions on, feel free to pull those out. We'll be glad to explain any questions that you may have.
I would like to pull out 8C, the Elon University Pyrotechnics Display.
Is that an indoor?
Yes, sir. That will be an indoor event in the alumni gymnasium. They're having an off-site group come in and do a small pyro show. It'll actually be a juggling act of flames that the individual will be juggling. One of our inspectors will be there that night to observe this. They have provided us with a site plan for the FAA codes and requirements that are involved there, and everything has been approved. Of course, we will be on site that night.
The reason I asked that was the nightclub somewhere up north where they had so many people die.
Yes, sir. That is one reason why we want an inspector there, yeah. And that's why we are permitting through the county commissioner any one of these events.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Anything else on here that anybody wants to? Is everybody okay with CDB block grants? Meet the services block grants? Okay. Do I hear a motion that we approve?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Okay, the next thing, we are going to go into closed session, and I will now move that we go into the closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A6 to finalize our offer for our new county manager, which is a personnel issue. So at this point, do I hear a motion for that?
I'll make a motion. We go into closed session.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
We will return